someone to take any kind of joy in the failure of someone else. However, I have to confess in humility and embarrassment that last year I celebrated the fact that a major North American corporation declared bankruptcy. The corporation was Columbia House Records. And some others of you clearly are laughing because you also celebrated. When I was 16 years old, I entered into a covenant with Columbia House. And everybody knew, oh, okay. And it almost ruined my teenage years. Because I fell for that covenant whereby if you paid a penny, they would send you 10 albums of your choice. And of course, I sent my penny in, and they didn't quite have the albums that I wanted, and they convinced me to take other ones, and that was sort of a crummy part of the covenant, but I had a new 8-track player in my car, and I really wanted something to play. The worst part was then that if you accepted one side of the covenant, which was the free 8-track tapes for a penny, you had to agree to buy a certain number of 8-track tapes over the next year at regular prices. And believe me, Columbia House was not losing any money on that 10 for a penny deal. Even worse than that, with this horrible covenant, was that every month they had a special selection. And they would send you a card, and if you didn't send the card back, they would send you the special selection of the month. And I don't know what, I was so distracted and disorganized, I never sent the card back. And so I always got their selection of the month, which was always some really horrible, easy listening thing that nobody wanted. So in my teenage years, my friends were saying to me, "Whoa, Mark, have you heard that new Black Sabbath album? It's wicked." And I go, "No, but I do have Nana Mouskouri singing the roads. Some say love, it is a river that drowns the tender reed." What is this I'm listening to? And then I'd be in my car at a stoplight and some guy would pull up beside me blasting out Alice Cooper, "Welcome to My Nightmare," and I would do my best to crank up Bobby Vinton. And it was horrible. And I'm pretty sure that up until last year, they were still sending me 8-track tapes of the Raycon singers. So when they went bankrupt, I breathed a sigh of relief. I am finally out of that covenant. Covenants can be really scary because they engage you and they involve you and you can't get out. And if you think that Columbia House was scary, you should know the way that people made covenants 4,000 years ago in the days of Abraham. If you wanted to make a covenant to trade sheep or goats with somebody, what you would do is the two people would get together, they would cut a sheep in half, let its blood drain out onto the stony ground, and then each man in turn would take off his sandals and walk through the pathway of blood and say to the other man, "If I don't live up to this covenant, you may spill my blood as we have spilled the blood of this sheep." That was how you made a covenant, and it was serious. You can imagine how Abram would have felt when God came to him in a dream and said, "Abram, I want to make a covenant with you." Now imagine the fear that you would feel up front thinking, "Oh my goodness, if I can't live up to this, what's going to happen to me?" And so Abram backed out. He said, I don't want to be in this covenant. It is too difficult for me." And the other strange thing is that Abram backed out because this disembodied voice could not walk the pathway of blood. So Abram said, how do I even know you will keep your side of the covenant? And he said, I'll have nothing to do with it. But the voice compelled him, saying, come with me out to a stony place in the desert, and you are going to bring with you a cow, a ram, a sheep, a dove, and a pigeon. And Abram said, all right, I will go. And the voice told him to cut each of those animals in half, and they would have been cut in half lengthwise for the maximum spillage of blood. And he lined up the two halves of the cow and the two halves of the goat and the two halves of the sheep, and he left the dove and the pigeon whole, and the blood poured like a river. But Abram was not going to walk in that river. It was too frightening. And he knew that this voice that was speaking to him couldn't walk through the river either, because it was only a voice. And the sun was setting, and he sat there and he looked at those animals, and he looked at that blood path, and he wondered, why have I come here? And then a strange thing happened. In the distance, he saw a column of black smoke moving towards him. And the column of black smoke came closer and closer and came into that place in between the halves of those animals, and the column of black smoke moved down through the blood path, through the animals. And he knew that that was the presence of God walking the pathway, making the covenant, saying, I will keep my covenant with you, Abram, and if I do not, you may spill my blood. And then, of course, in keeping with the custom, it was time for Abram to walk the blood path. But he would not. He said, there's no way that I am going to enter into this covenant. It is too frightening. It is too powerful. It would put a bind upon me that I could not keep. It may well have been that Abram had previously belonged to Columbia House. No way. So there would be no covenant that day. But all of a sudden, Abram heard a sound. It was the sound like the rushing of a waterfall, the sound like wind in the midst of a great storm. And there on the horizon, he saw approaching a column of fire. And as it came closer, he felt that the fire was throwing off heat like a blast furnace and throwing off light like the sun itself. There came this roaring column of fire, and the column of fire went down in between the animals through the blood path. Then he understood that this God did not expect him to walk the blood path. Instead, what happened, God walked the blood path twice. Once for himself, saying, Abram, if I break this covenant, you may spill my blood. And then that God, in the form of a column of fire, walked the blood path a second time, saying, if I break this covenant, you may spill my blood, and if you break this covenant, you may spill my blood. I will uphold both sides of the covenant. No matter what happens, I will love you, I will be with you, I will protect you, I will save you, I will be your God. No matter what you do, this is my covenant, and I hold up both sides of it. And now we see the way that God makes covenants with humankind is not the way that humankind makes covenants with itself. In a human covenant, there's always this balance. If you do this, I will do this. But with God, no matter what you do, I will love you. I will be your God. I will hold you close. We are in the season of Lent. We are heading towards that great day of Easter. And we know that on Easter we celebrate the resurrection. There is the fulfillment of the covenant. Following up after the cross of Calvary, in which God says, look, you broke my covenant. So I will let you shed my blood to compensate and to balance. That is the gospel that the Apostle Paul preached to the people, saying to them, whatever you do, God loves you because he has died for you in the person of Jesus Christ. God is with you. God is on your side. God loves you. And of course, the people struggled with that because they didn't understand this one-sided covenant. And they complained to Paul, saying, well then, why should we ever do anything good? And that's when Paul wrote to the church in Rome, saying, what then? Shall we sin so that grace may abound? Certainly not. When you were baptized into the death of Jesus Christ. And if you were baptized into his death, you were also baptized into his resurrection, that you should live forever. And in being raised again, you are new people. At Romans 6:15, the question comes up again, saying, what then? Should we sin because we don't live under the law but under grace? And Paul says, by no means. You were once the slaves of sin, and you had to do what sin told you. But through his death and resurrection, you have been set free from slavery. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God through Jesus Christ is life eternal. And the thing that those people didn't understand was this, that hearing the message of the unconditional love of God is the thing that changes us, and the only thing that changes us. There are people in the church today who think the only way you can get anybody to do anything that is good is to say to them, if you do good, God will love you. If you do wrong, God will despise and punish you. They never saw what happened in the covenant with Abraham. They do not understand what happened on the cross of Calvary. There are no conditions. There is no if you do this, God will. There is only God will love you no matter what. And the Apostle Paul and Jesus Christ believed that hearing the good news is the only thing that changes and elevates a human being so that they can do good. So I proclaim to you anew today this gospel. God loves you. God will always love you. In covenant with Abraham, God said, whatever you do, I will uphold both sides of the covenant. And 2,000 years ago on the cross of Calvary, God said, look, this is how much I love you. You have broken the covenant. It doesn't matter. I promise Abraham and I promise you, whatever you do, I love you. I redeem you. I save you. You are my people. I will never let you go. And I am confident that in hearing that good news again today, you have become new people, and you will go out and do wonderful things. In the name of Christ, amen. And that is beautiful. When Jesus came into the world, he came to a people that did not understand the power of God's covenant. And Jesus said to them, remember, whatever you do, I will love you. I have died for you and been raised again for you, and I will always be faithful. So all of us today will celebrate our baptism as we celebrate Cora's baptism, knowing that it is the
outward sign and seal of our dying and rising in Christ, the engrafting into God's family, the forgiveness of sins, and that new life that begins when we hear the message and the Holy Spirit comes in. As you present this child for baptism, I ask two questions of you and ask you to respond by saying, do you confess your faith in God as your Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ as your Savior, and the Holy Spirit as your Sanctifier? And do you promise that you will raise Cora with an awareness of God's wonderful love? All right. And Cora, do you want to come and see me? Are you ready? Okay, you're looking great. And do you want to have a look at all these people out here? Go for a little walk. These are people who love you and care about you and will always be with you no matter what. They are people who are going to build up this church so it's always a place of tenderness and love and of mercy. And at this time, I invite the whole congregation to please stand. Do you promise that you will do all in your power to see that St. Andrew's is always a place filled with love, a people who understand that God will love us no matter what, so that when Cora comes here, she will find the tenderness in which you have lived your lives? And if so, please shout out, we do.
We do.
Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.